möchte euch und Sie herzlich begrüßen. Als Gastgeber Forum 3 bin ich gebeten worden, ein paar Worte zu Anfang zu finden. Mein Name ist Ulrich Morgenthaler. Zusammen mit meiner Frau Gabi und unserem Praktikanten Jonas, auf unseren Namensschildern steht das Forum 3 drunter, können Sie sich alle gerne während der Tagung mit irgendwelchen technischen oder organisatorischen Fragen an uns wenden. Genauso wie an die Leute, die am Tagungsbüro sitzen oder die auf dem Namensschild Kolibri stehen haben. Kurz zu Ihrer Orientierung. Das Forum 3 ist ein Jugend- und Kulturzentrum. Wir haben ein Café, Theater, Vorträge, Abendkurse, Wochenendseminare und wir stellen gerne unser Haus zur Verfügung für Initiativen und Aktivitäten aller Art, insbesondere, und ich zitiere einen Satz aus unserer Satzung, um beizutragen zu den brennenden Problemen unserer Zeit, dafür Lösungen zu suchen. Wir sind jetzt im 43. Jahr, entstanden aus der oder während der 68er Zeit. Während dieser Zeit sind die Probleme nicht weniger oder nicht weniger brennend geworden, aber sie sind doch auch so bearbeitet worden, dass etwas entstanden ist dabei. Und insofern geben wir gerne unser Haus für diese Konferenz heute Abend zur Verfügung. Und ich möchte als Motiv für das gute Gelingen gerne einen kurzen Absatz vorlesen. Ich selbst bin erst 35 Jahre hier dabei. Ich bin nicht am Anfang dabei gewesen, aber wie ich kam, bin ich auf ein Buch gestoßen, wo ich völlig überrascht war, dass es so etwas gibt. Und das Motto, das Motiv dieses Buches lebt die ganze Zeit im Hintergrund dieser Arbeit mit. Und das möchte ich kurz vorlesen, was ich da als Zitat habe. Jedes Mal, wo man daran ging, zu diesem alten Prinzip der gegenseitigen Hilfe zurückzukehren, wurde seine Grundidee erweitert. Vom Clan dehnte es sich zur Völkerschaft aus, zum Bund der Völkerschaften, zum Volk und schließlich, wenigstens im Ideal, zur ganzen Menschheit. Zugleich wurde es auch veredelt. Im ursprünglichen Buddhismus, im Urchristentum, in den Schriften mancher muslimischen Lehrer, in den ersten Schriften der Reformation und besonders in den ethischen und philosophischen Bewegungen des letzten 19. Jahrhunderts und unserer eigenen Zeit setzt sich der völlige Verzicht auf die Idee der Rache oder Vergeltung, gut um gut und übel um übel, immer kräftiger durch. Die höhere Vorstellung, keine Rache für Übeltaten und freiwillig mehr zu geben, als man von seinen Nächsten zu erhalten erwartet, wird als das wahre Moralprinzip verkündigt. Als ein Prinzip, das wertvoller ist als der Grundsatz des gleichen Maßes oder die Gerechtigkeit und das geeigneter ist, Glück zu schaffen. Und der Mensch wird aufgefordert, sich in seinen Handlungen nicht bloß durch die Liebe leiten zu lassen, die sich immer nur auf Personen, bestenfalls auf den Stamm bezieht, sondern durch das Bewusstsein seiner Einheit mit jedem Menschen. In der Betätigung gegenseitiger Hilfe, die wir bis an die ersten Anfänge der Entwicklung verfolgen können, finden wir also den positiven und unzweifelhaften Ursprung unserer Moralvorstellungen. Und wir können behaupten, dass in dem ethischen Fortschritt des Menschen der gegenseitige Beistand, nicht gegenseitiger Kampf, den Hauptanteil gehabt hat. In seiner umfassenden Betätigung, auch in unserer Zeit, erblicken wir die beste Bürgschaft für eine noch stolzere Entwicklung der Menschheit. So der von 1842 bis 1921 lebende russische Anarchist, Geograf und Schriftsteller Peter Kropotkin in seinem Buch Gegenseitige Hilfe in der Tier- und Menschenwelt. In diesem Sinne ein gutes Gelingen für diese Konferenz. Kooperation statt Konkurrenz.
Schönen guten Abend. Ich möchte Sie ganz herzlich begrüßen zu unserer Tagung, die von heute Abend bis Sonntagnachmittag gehen wird. Kooperation statt Konkurrenz. Ist ein solidarisches Handelssystem möglich? Und wir alle ringen nach Antworten auf solche schwierigen Fragen. Und insofern freue ich mich sehr über diese Tagung. Ich denke, wir werden hier zweieinhalb spannende Tage miteinander erleben. Mein Name ist Caroline Kalenius. Ich koordiniere die Kampagne für Ernährungssicherheit bei Brot für die Welt. Und ich werde jetzt mal heute Abend versuchen, ein bisschen hier die Diskussion zu moderieren und Ihnen auch nachher noch unsere zwei Referenten des heutigen Abends ankündigen. Heute Abend wollen wir einen Einstieg in die Tagung vornehmen und quasi das große Tableau eröffnen, das wir morgen dann noch weiter vertiefen werden in den einzelnen Foren. Dafür haben wir zwei Referenten eingeladen und diesen zwei Experten haben wir die gleiche Frage gestellt. Und zwar die Frage ist, ein solidarisches Handelssystem möglich? Und wir hoffen da spannende Einblicke zu bekommen. Ich freue mich sehr, dass Timothy Kondo aus Simbabwe und Christian Felber heute Abend hier sind und uns da auch einen Einblick geben in die Thematik. Vielen Dank, dass Sie da sind. Timothy Kondo ist aus Harare in Simbabwe. Er ist Gewerkschaftler seit 1972 und hat aber in unterschiedlichen Bereichen gearbeitet. Seit 2006 aber ist er Programmdirektor von ANSA. Und ANSA ist ein Netzwerk, das den Titel unserer Konferenz eigentlich schon im Namen trägt. Alternatives to Neoliberalism in Southern Africa. Also Alternativen zum Neoliberalismus im südlichen Afrika. Und dieses Netzwerk arbeitet, wie er mir vorhin gesagt hat, ganz viel mit gewerkschaftlichen Organisationen, aber eben nicht nur, auch mit Basisorganisationen und versuchen quasi von unten zu gucken, was bedeutet das eigentlich in den Ländern. Und insofern machen sie regionale Studien auch und nationale und gehen eben mit ganz vielen Seminaren und Veranstaltungen auch in die Region. Timothy, you got the floor. Bitte schön. Okay.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. First and foremost, I'm very delighted to be invited to participate in this very important conference. Secondly, I would like to advise that the time given to me for this discussion is only 15 minutes. And having been a trade union activist for almost 40 years, 15 minutes will go by before I say anything, before I even start to talk. So I have to be careful and manage my time very carefully. Right, I would like to start from introducing the program ANSA, Alternatives to Neoliberalism in Southern Africa. I have a brochure here. I think in the end all of us can pick one, those who are interested. I will give them to Caroline. Right. This is an initiative that was born from Zimbabwe around between 1991 and 1995. What happened then was that we were 10 years into independence. We got our independence in 1980, and our government had pronounced that the policy that they will embark upon was to bring about a socialist economy, a socialist society. However, at the turn of the century, of the decade, our government had to make reforms, had to take a program which they called ESAP, Economic Structural Adjustment Program. And it was the trade unions at that particular time who said to government, no, you can't take this program. This program, although government said it was homegrown, from the trade union side we said, this is not homegrown, this is coming from the IMF and the World Bank, and the promises that you are made, that are made in this by this program are false. We are not going to see employment increasing. We are not going to see the livelihood of people increasing. Instead, we are going to see the opposite. But government had already committed itself, and in 1991, they started to implement that program. That sewed up the relationship between the government and the trade union, the National Trade Union Center. Somehow, 1993, we decided as the trade union that we have to find a way to negotiate with the government. And we said, sometimes it doesn't make sense to just say, this policy doesn't work. Probably we would say, this policy doesn't work, why not try this? So we, the trade union, produced a book then called Beyond ESAP and I Am Beyond Economic Structural Adjustment Program. And I am reliably informed that that book was translated into Germany then. I think with the help of organizations like Friedrich Ebert Stiftung or others. So when we did that, we are, as the National Center, affiliated to a regional trade union body called SATUC, Southern Africa Trade Union Coordinating Council. This council said, this is a brilliant idea that ZCTU has done, but you cannot fight this IMF World Bank program alone. And it's not only affecting Zimbabwe, it's affecting all other countries. Why should we not take a regional approach and attack this monster from a regional point of view? This is when the idea to bring about the ANSA program was hatched. That was now in May 1996 that SATUC decided that we should begin now to work around a regional program that looks up at these neoliberal policy programs. So 2003, it took us some time. 2003, a concept note for this program was produced, and seminars started, meetings started, and we had this whole question, are we going to make it an organization? Are we going to make it a service arm? What are we going to do? Then we decided that it should just remain a support program. And the next important question was, okay, this initiative is coming from the trade union. Are we going to restrict it to the trade unions only? Or are we going to involve who else? Right? And the decision was that this is a program for us all. This is a program for every person in our region. So the trade union is only the entry point or the initiator, but the agenda is everybody else's agenda. So we have an approach in ANSA where when we are running activities, they are coordinated by the national trade union in the country, but they involve every other non-stakeholder, right? As for government, we need them only when we are negotiating with them over an agreed position. The first stage, as you shall see when I go into a bit detail, the first stage is for the civic society or non-state actors, or rather we like to call ourselves the victims of the system. When we develop our position together, then we approach government and say, right, government, this is how it is affecting us, these are our ideas, how can we go forward? Right, so this is going to be my presentation, and now I'm going to the formal presentation. We said ANSA is not an organization, is just a network. So this network is guided by a set of principles. Right? So the principles are 10 of them. The first principle is that for a development strategy, it must be led by the people. This way we are talking in terms of a development strategy against that development strategy coming from the IMF and World Bank. Right? Said, so, people must sit around, government, people, civic society, and say, this is the development strategy that we want to have in our country. The second one is that the auto-centric development based on domestic needs and the use of local resources. Auto-centric, internally driven kind of development than externally driven development to satisfy the needs of the market there in Japan or elsewhere without satisfying our own needs at the local level. The third one is regional integration led from the grassroots. Yes, we have our SADC, and I am not here to complain or to criticize structures that we build down there. But we call it a club for our leaders, for our politicians. It doesn't come down really to the people. So we would like to see a regional integration that identifies itself with the people within the region, not just a club for the politician, right? Number four is selective delinking and negotiated relinking. Here we mean programs like the current one, which is part of the discussion of this conference, I assume, the Economic Partnership Agreement, for example. We say no to APAS. And what do we mean? We want to de-link ourselves from such kind of programs that we perceive unfair. But we are not imagining building a Berlin Wall between those we have been trading with. Globalization is underway. So we relink on negotiated terms. Right. Principle number five talks about alternative science and technology. You know, in our third world countries, we are totally, if I may say, dependent on science and technology from elsewhere. But we have had our own science, and we can also do something to promote our own science and our own technology. And science and technology causes a lot of bleeding in our countries because we export so much of our money to acquire technology, instead of technology helping us to promote our economies. In other ways, we have technology that compromises us because we pay more for the technology than we get out of it. Number six is national, regional, and global progressive alliances. Right.
This workshop is already being organized by an alliance of organizations introduced by Caroline. This is the network that we are looking at. We now no longer believe in the old politics of black or white. The world is globalizing. Everybody is living everywhere. I travel everywhere. I find Zimbabweans happy there. And I also find Germans in Namibia last week when I was there, and they are happy. So we so when we talk of alliances, we are not talking of alliances in terms of the power structures. We are talking of alliances in terms of values and common interests of human society. So that kind of alliance knows no border. But the starting point, of course, is the national level, where the workers, the peasants, the informal economy in our country, which is now 80% of the population, all work together and collaborate, right? Then we have redistribution of wealth to empower the non-formal sectors. This is better understood in third world economies. I was just saying that our formal employment now employs less than 20% people. And 80% of the people you find in the informal economy. And this informal economy includes the rural farmer or the peasants. It's not formal. Right. So we want an economy that sees backward and forward linkages being created between the formal and the non-formal economies. Right. We go, principle number 8 is gender rights as a basis for development. Here we have some bit of bias, I'm sorry. We have a bit of bias in that gender does not mean men or women. Gender talks about the role of men and women in society. But if from an answer perspective, we have a bias to promote the women. Because in reality, in Africa, or in our region, to be precise, that there is a yawning gap of inequality between men and women. And it goes back to our history. Yes, we have some negative elements in our culture, and we have also inherited systems designed by former colonial governments, and colonialism also gave greater benefits to men than women. I don't have time. I would have liked to tell this story. It's a short one. My grandmother would tell me about. My grandfather went to South Africa as a mine worker. He comes there with what was called a gramophone, an old radio. He would wind it, then it starts to make music. And when he came with this box, my old grandmother would not touch that thing. She didn't know what it was. And she was busy cooking, running around to organize a meal for the husband. Then he winded up the gramophone, put this record on, and left the room. And then it started to sing. The old woman says, she ran out of the house like mad. Says, what kind of a thing is this? So you can already see how colonialism has helped to develop the men and underdevelop the women. That's where that's just an example of the imbalance of development. Right. Principle number 9 is education for sustainable human development. I think our education systems in Africa, in particular, must change. We are still largely using the old education system, which was designed by the colonial masters of the time to get us to be productive labor. So it was not education to emancipate us. So we want education that will emancipate the current and future generations. Then the last one and most important is we want a dynamic, participatory, and radical democracy. This would appear to be the current problem of Africa. If you take what's happening in North Africa, in the Arab Africa, it's a deficit of democracy. It's not a deficit of sovereignty. Libya is a sovereign state. But what you don't get there is the democracy, the space for people to participate. What we have achieved through our hard-won struggles for independence, like in my country, Zimbabwe, we have achieved what we now call representative democracy, where we have a right to choose Mr. So-and-so or Mrs. So-and-so to represent us in the council, to represent us in parliament, and that person knows it all for us. We are not participating. So we say we should now be moving from that representative democracy as the first step to a participatory kind of democracy. And you know, people can only participate if they are informed. Sometimes you want to participate. I have seen people who say, I want to do something. What do you want to do? Anything that you can ask, give me to do. He has nothing himself to offer or herself to offer. Then you cannot be participating. This is the teaching of answer, right? 2 minutes. This is the teaching of answer that I am now going to be reading and concluding. We say, ideas are a powerful force once they are seized by the vast numbers of people. The Alternatives to Neoliberalism in Southern Africa initiative provides the building blocks for a common perspective on alternative policies and strategies in Southern Africa, which can bring about people-driven sustainable human development. ANSA is not an organization. It merely provides a stimulus, a direction for countless localized centers of struggle and resistance and initiatives for alternatives to join forces and pressurize for change from a common perspective. So, join us. And together, we will shape a mass movement which will successfully advocate for radical alternative in Southern Africa. Another Africa is already in the making. My journey to come to Stuttgart started with the first step from my door some 24 hours ago. So we say, another Africa is in the making because we have already started to think around an alternative system of governance and system of development. I thank you.
Very lively presentation. Let me give you this. I'm very much amazed that after 20 years of structural adjustment programs, you come up with 10 principles which are really something very different than what the economic programs are all about. So what we do now is to give you the opportunities to ask questions.
Thank you, Timothy. That was a brilliant presentation. In addressing your vision, you mentioned a sustainable development and the people's base and so forth. And currently in the German discussions and European discussions, raw materials for that sustainable development are very high on the agenda of our industry. What is your discussion in the Southern African region on raw materials, natural resources being shipped to Europe? Thank you.
Okay. Right. The first question is about results. What results so far? Right. Implementation of the ANSA program started in 2006. The whole idea of working it out started 2003. So 2003 to 2006, we produced the ANSA book. I will show it tomorrow. I just brought one copy. It is on the ANSA website, but tomorrow I will show the book. This book discusses 15 chapters, right? From a regional perspective. That's the first outcome. The second result was that after producing the book, then a program secretariat was put in place. And that's the secretariat that I coordinate. And the third result is that the ANSA book has been launched now in the 14 countries of the SADC region. And that book has been translated into a popular version. I will also bring the popular version tomorrow to show you. Summarized, simplified, for people with a humble education to be able to read and understand and get something out of it. Fourth key result area is that we said the book gives a regional, a helicopter view for the region. It's not country specific. So people in their own country must begin to think around producing their own alternative studies. And so far, I will again show it tomorrow. Zimbabwe has produced this size of a book, I will show it tomorrow, which they call Beyond Enclave. And it has 13 chapters, including mining, including agriculture, manufacturing, trade, and so on. Namibia, they said, we don't have so much capacity for everything, but our priority area is youth unemployment. And they have already produced their book that we launched 2 weeks ago on youth unemployment. Zambia has produced, we are going to be launching on the 14th of December their national book comprising 5 chapters that include mining, because mining is key in Zambia. Malawi, they have also produced their own book, and we are going to be launching this one either on the 18th or 19th of December. It covers 5 chapters, and their key chapter is agriculture, because that's an agro-based economy. Mauritius, they are supposed to be launching their book in January, February next year. We are busy editing their final draft. So those are some of the results. We can talk about the results we can show you of the ANSA program. Then traditional structures for democracy. Thank you. He knows Africa. from that input, traditionally, if my father would sell a cow to send me to school, what he would always do, I went to school because my father would sell a cow and so on. He would sit together with us, mom in the kitchen, myself, my brothers, my sisters, and say, we need £10 for Timothy to go for his second term. Now, of our 9 cows, which one do you think we should sell? He will have already in mind one to sell, but he will ask us. And sometimes it was us who will influence which one to go. The one that causes us trouble when we are looking after them in the fields, they will say, ah, take away that one. That one, no, because it produces a lot more milk. This one, no, because it does not cause us problems for spanning.
You also, that's why I came to the family level. Let's go to a village level. You have a village headman. Something happens. He calls around. You see the difference. Men sit this side, women sit the other side. But they all participate. We have this round kind of thing. Even if you go to a chief's dare, what we call the chief's court, it's structured all the same. But these are things that were regarded taboo by the colonial regime. The colonial education is what damaged that, it poured acid on that fabric. So when we talk of participatory democracy, it's something that is not coming from elsewhere. It's coming, it's something that is coming from our own being, from our own culture and traditions. And our leaders don't like it now. They like to take their decisions in closed sessions, and when they come there, the security guards will push you away, and they keep their lips tight, and they only speak when the television people are there, and you don't respond. Right. Finally, the issue of raw materials. Oh, this is a whole subject. This is a whole crucial subject. Yes, Africa, we are endowed with diverse raw materials. And the kind of trade that is taking place between Southern Africa, the North, even the East now, is that kind of trade where we sell our raw materials and import back finished products. There are campaigns, my friend, who asked the question. There are campaigns, though small, though very small now, but there are such other campaigns that are beginning to emerge where people say, better keep our minerals underground if we have no use for them now. Our future generations will use them if they have better use for them. So, the issue of natural resources is key and very important. But this is the issue of our underdevelopment. Because if we were technologically and scientifically developed, then those resources would do us much better than export them raw and get them back as finished products, which we can't afford to buy. Botswana is popular of its diamonds. Let's go all together now to Gaborone and see how many of the Botswana women have a ring with a diamond ring on it. It has no use for them. And even if one would love to have it, she won't have the money to buy that kind of thing. So the issue of resources, the issue of our raw materials is quite an important issue, but it's quite a huge debate. It needs a workshop on its own. Like for now, there was a scramble for Africa earlier, starting 1884, Berlin Conference, which partitioned Africa. But now the scramble has shifted from Europe to Asia. If you are aware, if you may not be aware, 2 years ago there was an Africa-China conference where China and our African leaders were discussing about cooperation and development and translating into the same effect of China occupying the resource areas of Africa. So it's quite a big debate. I'm just teasing out. Thank you.
Ja, vielen Dank, Timothy. Du hast jetzt eine kleine Pause. You have a short break now.
Yeah.
And then we'll discuss later all the other questions that might come now from the audience, and you might react to what Christian will tell us.
Oh, okay.
So, thank you very much.